Herpen, that's it. Who's really known internationally for her kind of pioneering and experimental designs, and who since 2011 has been showing as part of the haute couture schedule in Paris. But we'll also be looking at the work of Nixi Killick, who's visually arresting hybrid practice, also kind of, I guess, creating a bit of a groundswell locally. And so we'll be talking about all of those things. But before I start, I just wanted to define technology a bit, because I think we all are so used to being a part of our everyday lives. I mean, you know, hands up who doesn't have a smartphone? But within the fashion industry, I think technology is really changing the way that clothing is designed, how it's fabricated, how we see it, and how we consume it. And I think we all tend to assume it's a very 21st century kind of digital phenomenon, and certainly that it, you know, sometimes produces works that kind of look like this. But what I want to make the point is that since the mid-18th century, technology has been a part of fashion and fashion innovation. And where we are today, I think, is just at one end of a very long continuum. And so what I've done is I've just printed off some pictures, which are kind of, I guess, just signals for the kinds of technology, you know, that fashion has been associated with along the way. So I've got a dress from the 19th century, which is the product of an invention known as the jacquard loom, which was invented in 1801, and which allowed the production, was it 10 times faster than a hand loom, and it allowed the production of all these great innovative textiles, which we know today as kind of brocades and damasks. I also have a dress, Pierre Cardin, 1968, the first seamless dress, and it was called the Cardin dress, and it was created with a kind of a heat process and bonding that produced these wonderful kind of three-dimensional sculptural elements at the bottom. And a work, finally, which is on display in the case just around the corner to my right, which is Iris van Herpen's collaboration with Johan Vandermeer, her magnetic shoes, where she created a material that was comprised, like a polymer that was comprised of iron filings, and then the shoes were, the material was put under a giant magnet and it pulled the filings up towards it and created this wonderful kind of textured surface. So these are all sort of, I guess, innovations in fashion that are a result of kind of new technologies and in pioneering kind of thinking and, you know, advancements. And I think what they do is they change the kind of aesthetic vocabulary of fashion. So they allow not only, you know, what we do, you know, the kind of materials we make, but also the, you know, the way that these things can be constructed and the way that fashion looks. But I also want to make the point too that technology is always just a tool. So when we think about, a lot of, I guess, things like, electronic wearables and, you know, fabrics with made with nanofibers, which allow, you know, particular, you know, biological triggers or, response to, you know, the body responding to heat, those kinds of things. It still is always the result of kind of creative thinking and inspiration. And Iris herself has said that, you know, like, it's like writing a book. If I was, you know, to write a story, in the old days I would use pen and paper. Today I use a computer, but it's always the thinking and the inspiration behind the work. And so I think that's something to bear in mind when we talk today and when we think about technology and what it offers designers and how we use it. Is it, you know, it does always come back to the kind of original thinking and the kind of the concepts behind the garment. So, you know, Iris is somebody who's known very much for kind of her interdisciplinary practice. And she, while she's a fashion designer, she also, you know, has a background in dance. She seeks out collaborations with engineers, with architects, with jewellery designers. And so I wanted to ask Nikki how you see yourself and how you define yourself, because when we look at the website, the word Imagineer comes up straight away.
Yeah, cool. Well, hey everyone, thanks for coming. I call myself an Imagineer, which I find is just really, is a term that I can break through the barriers of the definition by your creative practice. So often, even in a space like this, you're categorised on the plaque as a photographer, a fashion designer, a painter, an artist, a printmaker. But that term comes so loaded with all of this other knowledge that you have from, you know, all of the different avenues of your kind of creative learning. But for me, that term just cuts through all that and in a way disjoints you and maybe confuses you a little bit. So maybe it is part of that learning, of figuring out how to describe your practice. If you can create a conversation immediately, then you are doing just as much learning as other people are when you talk about your work. So I think for me, imaginary has become a term that really just allows me to go beyond the limitations of the practice people can kind of box you into. So fashion, I think, I mean, any creative field can be a bit like that. Your idea of it is based on your knowledge and, you know, understanding of the history of it. So especially in fashion, a lot of people, if you say, oh yeah, I'm a fashion designer, I think, oh cool, yeah, fabulous dresses. But as you can see with Iris's work also, it breaks out into a lot of different fields, using a lot of different materials and experimental methodologies. That explaining those is easier, I think, if at the beginning you just bamboozle everyone.
So what does a Nixi Killick collection look like?
Whoa, great question. I guess for me, I'm constantly coming back to this relationship between nature and technology. So that's where, for me, utilizing these tools, it really is this conversation about looking at what incredible technologies exist and using that as inspiration. If you think about the phenomenal existence of color-changing animals and, you know, all these amazing things that happen already at biological processes or things that exist through evolution of plant and animal and just our known universe, that as a starting point is such an incredible space to fantasize about what you can create, and then technology becomes a language and a language of different tools that you can use to really, I guess, usher into existence your ideas around that, and then perhaps an evolution of your practice and your ways of describing. So again, your language using these tools.
So then, what is your particular relationship to technology? How do you integrate that into your design process?
I guess that comes from a hunger for experimental practice and this idea of hybridity, I guess, in your work ethic. So I've spoken a lot in my, academic growth about hybrid practice, and I think that's where it really does come back to trying to step out of the constructive frameworks in terms of materials and in terms of design and aesthetic. So for me, technology has always been a really accessible portal for that, but it really is about having to chase down those things. University obviously is the best space to start. I was really lucky at RMIT. We have so much access to that kind of stuff, so really things like laser cutting and 3D printing and that kind of stuff becomes a second nature. It becomes a language that you're used to using just because you have access to it.
And for you, what's the advantage of using technology? And maybe it might be a good point to sort of talk about what is your design process, you know, from start to finish, you know, what does it look like? And then what advantage does technology bring to that? Because there's a lot of designers today who still, you know, drape fabric on a stand or start with a sketch and then it's, you know, translated to a computer program and then the patterns spat out. So,
well, I guess every piece or every garment or every collection or every concept is going to have its own journey. But for me, it always begins with painting and drawing. Because my process and my practice is really split into two different parts. I sort of have this, 2D element where I'm working on these paintings which then go into the sublimation print on the streetwear. And then there's the experimental practice that really deals with more sculptural aspects and exploring different technologies and materials. So when I begin a collection, I'm trying to flesh out that concept and that visual schematic of what it's going to look like, which then informs how you're going to create that. I try and remove any kind of limitations again. So that's where painting and drawing, it really is that flow state of creating a really vivid experimental space that you can just explore with no restrictions on. If you're trying to already immediately go straight to an object-based thing or a resolved article, you're thinking already about how you're going to make it. But if you're just starting with a really amorphous abstract space, things start to evolve after that. So you start to think, you know, for example, you start to think about something that you're visually thinking about as a 2D texture, then starts to lift off the page as you imagine how you would construct it. So maybe that's about, you imagine this thing being very 3D and having all of these scales and elements coming out of it. So to try and realize that concept, you have to think, okay, cool, what technology can I employ as my partner in this situation to really filter that language through and create something that does justice to that initial fantasy. So I think in that translation, often those paintings become, I guess they become the jumping point, and then you go off into, okay, cool, so with this piece of work or whatever I'm thinking about, to put that together, is it laser cutting, is it fiber optics, is it 3D printing, is it a combination of all of these things, is it casting silicon, is it resin, is it, you know, some of those things, you know, some of the processes I've developed in this experimental practice have been a combination of those. So, you know, laser cutting a stencil that you're screen printing silicon into, and then you're going back and 3D printing into the material or something like that. So these processes really are, in a way, that most exciting experimental phase. So I guess technology is, for me, technology is essential. But as you were saying before, technology is as simple as a pencil. You know, before a pencil, how do we communicate? So I think if you try and think, try and break that down, it doesn't have to be like, that's why in terms of new technologies, it can be, there's a big disparity between people's ideas of this, the instantaneous nature of 3D printing and the actual facilitate of it in your practice. Like 3D printing especially, there's a massive wealth of knowledge you have to know about software and 3D modeling and that kind of stuff to even produce something that has some kind of depth to it. So there's sort of, those processes obviously always come with a sort of technical background. You've got to learn this, how to cast, you know, the ratios of how to cast the resin properly, all these sorts of things. So that in itself, I think really just diversifies your practice so that it's not just sketch dress, sew it up.
And certainly, I mean, when you have a look up close at some of the works on display here by Iris van Herpen, they all employ very different techniques to achieve, you know, very different outcomes. This particular dress here is the result of laser cut acrylic sheets, which have then been kind of hand sewn to a base garment to create these sort of conical three-dimensional shapes. The dress, which looks like it's a floating lace structure over the black bodycon sort of swoop underneath, that was created by a process of a heating process that made the plastic pliable, and then the plastic was then hand cut. So I think sometimes there's a lot of assumptions that everything is, you know, press a button and the dress magically appears. But it's about searching, as you say, for the technique that allows you to achieve the effect you want. The dress right at the end, the black dress, which makes use of negative space, that's laser cut. But then the panels have all been kind of hand sewn together. And I guess, like you're trying to say, it's about, you know, the marrying, you know, what your concept of a garment is with the kind of the right process to get there. And often sometimes that only comes out in the kind of trial and error stage, where you do something 100 times, trying to achieve an effect, and then by accident you stumble across something else. Or
and I think there's also some areas where, and I think there's a lot of creative people probably here that realise that as well, where you can spend hours and hours on something, and you can see these grand level work going to it, and the finished result looks seamless and easy and beautiful. But there's something about the amount of work that went into that, and the depth of research, the depth of upskilling, the depth of communication between you, your tool, you and your tools and your machinery, like, you know, what it took between man and machine to create that. I mean, that's a beautiful dance in itself.
Some of the things that you have successfully made using sort of 3D printing, can you give us some examples of things that appear in your collections that might show us what a final result is?
I've done quite a bit of accessory-based work, I guess. So in my graduate collection, I was looking, all the pieces that I made from that were based on 3D body scans. So I was doing body scans at RMIT of myself, and then of models, and then molding. So this was sort of part of my
experimental process and learning of 3D software, 3D modeling, which in itself is such an in-depth thing. That's again where, you know, especially at RMIT also, we have lots of students coming in going, I'm going to 3D print this wicked, amazingly intricate thing like Iris does. And it's like, okay, cool. Well, it actually is incredibly in-depth to create a form in 3D if you don't have any skills in that. So, you know, that as a process as well is a really great learning curve for you to get to know all the parts of that practice and that technology. I mean, it's like if you think about fabric just from the beginning stage, you don't make the fabric usually, you just cut it up and sew the dress. But for a lot of things, to find that final end point, there's so much that goes into it. So the work that I've sort of done in 3D printing, is mostly accessory based, and all of those things have come from scans of the human form. So making a lot of like chest plate kind of things and neck braces and bracelet things, like this is a 3D printed bracelet, but this was not modeled off a scan, but it was just a generic size. But I think for more sculptural forms, and in terms of your own practice, if you're not making it for a more ready-to-wear kind of fit, if you're making something that's more experimental piece, working from a 3D body scan has been a really great base to start, because obviously fashion is about addressing the body and sculpture is about addressing a form. So if you have that base, that's where you can kind of jump a few boxes for 3D modeling.
And of course, I guess that helps with, you know, there's a lot of talk about fit and the benefit of, you know, I guess 3D printing, being able to kind of customize to your own body and to your own patch. Thinking about your practice, you know, who are some of the people that have inspired you along the way?
Well, I guess I've been really lucky because I have quite a diverse background. So my inspiration has allowed me to think outside of that box and kind of coming from that direction, talking about hybrid practice. You know, I grew up in the circus, my parents are artists. My background is, in that sense, not really that linear. It is in the sense of coming towards fashion and being categorised in a fashion realm now. Looking at people like Nick Cave, who has some pieces downstairs, and the sound seals and things like that. But looking at body sculpture and looking at performance art in terms of the body and things like that, I think that's where those influences, those kind of abstract influences, can really mess things up a little bit in a great kind of way, like an experimental magical mistakes. But I think for me, inspiration-wise, Iris has been such a pinnacle. She's a legendary pioneer in the sense of marrying technology and fashion, but also her collaborations with other technicians and things like that. That's the sort of thing that I would like to get more, I guess, involved in. Because as I say, it's like those two things in themselves are such, you know, there's so much knowledge involved in the concept and the creative development, but also in the creation and rendering that into real life. You know, those are also such disparate realms. But trying to marry those also when you have other people who have so much more knowledge in that area would be really cool. Yeah, but all the people.
Within fashion, there's so many different, I guess, levels at which you can operate. There's a, you know, there's a ready-to-wear sphere, there's haute couture, there's, you know, and then there's, you know, set designers who we would consider much more avant-garde and experimental, and talking about bigger conversations and simply just, I guess, clothing. And so, you know, Iris is somebody who I think of in that particular category, someone like Hesse Chalil or Reiko or Cooper even, redefining kind of the relationship between clothing and the body, and also talking about kind of a lot of bigger ideas. And I think that's where artists' particular collaborations, I think, articulate their interest in, you know, kind of chaos theory, for example, or, you know, she works with a lot of architects and engineers.
But also some of the, like, I guess, more exterior kind of hybrid crew. There's some really amazing people like Lucy McCrae. She's a body architect. She does like ingestible perfumes, and she's working on preparing the body for space and doing some really experimental, I guess, explorations into addressing the body and addressing the future and addressing how the body and the future and technology can relate and how we can push those boundaries and just really questioning everything, which I think is generally a really amazing space to be in here and practice, if you really can just open everything up to be able to be able to soak in all those different things.
So what sort of excites you about the future, and what sort of possibilities that you see, you know, either other people doing, or, you know, where technology is headed for your own practice? What do you think? What do I want to get my hands on next and employ in my own work?
I think virtual reality is a really incredible realm for everyone, but particularly fashion and the body, and because it really does just collapse distance, time and space. It's something where you can really speak to a worldwide audience and really provide an immersive experience. Because I think that's the thing about wearables or in art in general, that experience is what it's all about in terms of being a maker. So providing that experience, but then if you can kind of create that in a full immersive environment, and it's not just to witness something that's static, it's to be a part of something and feel like that experience has been curated so that you are key to that. I think that's a really incredible space to work in. Like Jess Johnson's 3D experiences, I think, are amazing as well. That kind of thing, creating landscapes, creating worlds that you can participate in, really brings those fantasies to life, I guess.
I read about a dress that is constructed in such a way that if you don't look at it through a particular kind of lens, it looks like it's feathers moving and stuff.
Yeah.
It creates a great kinetic quality.
There's some incredible materials. Like there's some people doing some amazing work. I can't remember quite what they're called, but they're doing this, make this garment that reacts to emotion. So it's a series of, it's like basically a body grid, but then it has all of these little dials in it. And it reacts, it's like motion sensor, heat sensors and things like that. So it reacts to your body temperature changing, your movements and things like that, to realize, okay, cool, somebody's feeling vaguely in this way. It's like a mood ring clothing situation. But all of the, all the feathers will stand up if you're feeling a certain way around it. And heat temperature things like
makes me think of a cat with its hackles rising.
Yeah.
Just getting a little way from Nick, but we should, finish our chat and just open it up to any questions that people in the audience might have, either for myself or for Nixi. Great, all right. Okay, well, thank you very much for coming along and for staying with us. Do please have a wander around the rest of the triennial and have a look at his work online. One of the advantages of technology, you can go home and Google all you ever wanted to know. But yeah, thank you for coming along today and sharing your knowledge.